Sup YouTube, what's going on? Al Luminaire here, and welcome to Al's Analysis. This has been something that I've been wanting to do for a while now, and now that it's here, I'm very excited to share it with you all. What Al's Analysis essentially boils down to is me giving my honest opinions on a piece of media, be it a TV show, a movie, a video game, maybe even a comic book. Who knows? But with that out of the way, let's get on to today's topic, that being the Super Mario Bros. Movie. I know, very original, like hundreds of people haven't talked about it already, but I feel I have some things to say that others might have missed, and so I wanted to talk about that today. Just a side note, I'll only be talking about everything going up to the first trailer, as the second trailer and beyond that will be saved for another video. With that out of the way,
here we go!
Now, I first heard about this movie back in mid to late 2020, so about 3 years after the movie was announced. I was surprised to say the least, but given that the Sonic movie had come out that year, it wasn't a complete shock. Mario was always going to have a movie. If Sonic was going to do it, Mario probably did it first. After that, the movie admittedly slipped my mind for a good while. Like, it was partially because of the Sonic movie and like its post-credits stinger and all the speculation for that sequel. I didn't think about the Mario movie for a good long while after that. That is, until September 23rd. Yes, that September 23rd. Now for all you general audiences out there, a Nintendo Direct is a presentation that Nintendo does at least once every year to announce or provide updates on upcoming games. However, this Direct would be very special, as Nintendo would provide a massive update about the Super Mario Bros. Movie. More specifically, the cast list. And well, see for yourself. Yeah, this went as well as you'd expect. It definitely didn't help that after the announcement, we were only given a teaser poster showcasing the cast, and that Illumination would be helming the project. Now, I definitely don't love the choices that they made, but I can see how something like this would work in their mindset. Remember, Mario is a very iconic character, but at the same time, video game movies haven't exactly had the best reputation, so getting some form of star power would make sense in this context. However, I definitely feel that they could have made a better choice, like Ben Schwartz voiced Sonic. And yes, Ben Schwartz is a celebrity, but at the same time, he also has a bit of a voice acting career, and the voice he gives Sonic actually fits with the character. Sonic has had multiple voices, and thus, you can change the voice actor, but also give a different take on the character. Mario doesn't have that luxury. Charles Martinet has been the default voice since the 90s. Yeah, we had the Super Mario Bros. Cartoon before that, but every video game had a cartoon. And those cartoons don't necessarily translate to an accurate representation of the games they're based on. Also, for those saying that Mario's voice wouldn't work if he was speaking full sentences, Charles Martinet had like 25 years of experience before he did Mario. He mentions this in his interview for Great Big Story. He has the skills. He could do it. After that though, I kinda didn't see much in the way of progress towards the next big talking point. Yeah, people had their back and forth about the casting, as well as the absence of certain characters, but again, since all we got was a teaser poster and the cast list, I feel like they were running out of things to talk about. However, all that would change a little over a year later. Again, to all my general viewers, on October 4th, 2022, we were given a brand new teaser poster with the announcement that a Super Mario Bros. Movie Nintendo Direct would be releasing on October 6th, just 2 days later. Much like the cast announcement, this sparked massive speculation among the community, as up until that point, Nintendo had been basically radio silent, with the only other information being Chris Pratt saying that his Mario voice would be unlike anything you had ever heard. And as if to add more fuel to that fire, the designs for Mario, Peach, and Toad were basically leaked online less than a day before on a Happy Meal box of all things. And with that out of the way,
it's time for the moment you've been waiting for!
It all came down to this. 5 years and two of the craziest days of anyone's life. And what did I think of it? Well, it was pretty good. In fact, I'd say it was a solid teaser for what was to come. Although, as you can expect, I did have one problem.
It's me. Hi.
I'm the problem, it's me.
Chris Pratt's not Mario, and it messes with the immersion. For reference, of the cast members that were revealed, we got a taste of Keegan-Michael Key as Toad, Kevin Michael Richardson as Kamek, Jack Black as Bowser, and Chris Pratt as Mario. Now, I'll say it right off the bat, Jack Black was on point casting for Bowser. One of the things that's great about some of Jack Black's characters, like say, Po from Kung Fu Panda, is that he can play a character who's goofy, but also has a level of sincerity to them. I mean, Chris Pratt does the same thing, but at the same time, we don't really know that much about Mario's personality to really say that. Kevin Michael Richardson definitely gives a good performance from what we've heard. Admittedly, I haven't heard a lot of his voice work or anything he's been in, so I don't really know what to say about him. Now, Keegan-Michael Key as Toad? This is gonna sound a bit hypocritical because I just talked about how Charles Martinet was an experienced voice actor, but Toad definitely needed an overhaul in terms of voice. I mean, do you want to replace your windows every time he opens his mouth? Not only that, but the voice sounds enough like Toad, still being higher and a bit scratchy, that it doesn't come off as a phoned-in performance. I've heard Keegan-Michael Key's voice, and I can definitely say that he is trying his best. You know what I'm gonna say next. I'm really annoyed about Chris Pratt's Mario. I mean, props for holding up my expectations, but at the same time, I really wanted to be proven wrong. Chris Pratt isn't a bad voice actor. I mean, he was in the Lego Movie, something that everyone seems to forget. And so he's proven that he can do this kind of thing. The big problem, though, in my opinion, is just that I feel that either Chris Pratt wasn't trying, or they just wanted him to sound recognizable enough that, again, it would draw the parents in, which really bugs me. And like I said before, Jack Black can play goofy characters who have a level of sincerity to them. Like, Chris Pratt has done the same thing, but again, that isn't Mario. They really live up to the namesake, Chris Pratt as Mario. I don't hear Mario. I just hear Chris Pratt reading his lines with a slight Brooklyn accent I couldn't really tell. We'll see in the second trailer, but yeah. Now with that out of the way, let's move on to the visuals. Yeah, this movie looks great. Like, Illumination never looked bad in terms of its movies, but you can definitely tell that they have a sort of homogenized aesthetic when it came to their character designs and their locations. Mario does not have that problem. This is not Illumination's Mario movie. This looks like a Mario movie. None of this feels like quickly made crap or anything to cash in on the Mario iconography. Not just the locations, but also the character designs themselves. Like, there are little details that you wouldn't notice upon your first viewing that really make them. Like the green from Bowser's face creeping down to his shoulders. Toad having actual pants this time instead of some weird leg-foot hybrid thing. And Kamek having wrinkled skin because he's an older Koopa. For reference, he raised Bowser from literal infancy. Even Mario, for as much crap as I give him, looks amazing in this. Though I will admit, upon closer inspection, I noticed that his hands are slightly smaller, but that's just a minor nitpick. And yeah, that's basically everything I noticed in the trailer, as well as with all the discourse leading up to the movie. Overall, I am hesitantly optimistic for the Mario movie. On one hand, we aren't really dealing with a Sonic movie situation where a major change needs to be made before release. But at the same time, this could be the breeding ground for its own set of problems that Nintendo will have to fix. Who knows, maybe I could be wrong on all fronts, and this movie could be a masterpiece in every right. Wouldn't be the first time I was proven wrong. As much hate as I had towards the movie's low points, I definitely had a lot of fun seeing what I recognized in the trailer and pointing it out. Admittedly though, we still have another trailer to talk about, and the movie still needs to release. So, I might be wrong.
An identical outfit with a hat with the letter of his first name on it! Because I don't!
Phew! That Mario movie video is finally done. Now I can take a breather before... What? No. Well, I guess I gotta keep the momentum going.
Fuck!
Welcome back, everyone! This is the Al Eliminator speaking. I wasn't planning to do this again so soon, but given when I finished the last video, and the Mario movie's release, I thought it made a lot of sense to get things done as quickly as possible. But before that, you're probably wondering what you're even watching right now. For those who are unaware, this video is one in a series of videos I plan to make known as Al's Analysis. What Al's Analysis essentially boils down to is me giving my honest opinions on a piece of media, be it a TV show, a movie, a video game, maybe even a comic book, who knows? But with that out of the way, let's get on to today's topic, that being the Super Mario Bros. Movie. But before that, let's give a quick recap for any newcomers here. So, in the last video, I talked about how I didn't pay much attention to the Mario movie when it was initially announced. The movie continued to slip my mind until September 23rd, 2021, in which the cast list was revealed. I then proceeded to gripe about how Charles Martinet wasn't cast as Mario, and how the movie didn't have the benefit of multiple different versions of its character, unlike Sonic. Little over a year later, we were given a new teaser poster and news of an eventual trailer that would be coming out in 2 days. However, the designs for most of the major characters would be leaked on a Happy Meal box less than a day before the trailer released. And one heart attack later, I came to the conclusion that I couldn't have any notions about the trailer due to how little we were shown, though that didn't stop me from praising the visuals or most of the voice performances. Except you, of course. Which brings us to the present day, and begs the question of what came next. And well, you won't be surprised to hear this, but remember how the first trailer was announced 2 days before its release? Well, imagine my surprise when less than a month later, it's revealed that a second trailer will be rearing its ugly head around on November 29th. In fact, as of making this video, the third trailer has just been announced for the 9th of March. Less than 2 weeks from now. In fact, I nearly held off on making this video just so I could watch it and include it in here. But I decided not to. Not only for simplicity's sake, but because I feel this video is going to be a bit bigger than the last one. So before we get too sidetracked, let's get on to the second trailer.
A few moments later.
Okay, finally got that done. Now, for my opinion. This movie was announced in 2017. And then it took like 4 years for them to announce the cast list. And then a year after that, we get the first trailer. Like, I feel they waited a bit too long to get everything out. But at the same time, I feel like the Sonic movie released its trailer and a lot of the like revealed content was done more methodically. Like, it felt like it was happening gradually over the course of time. Whereas with the Mario movie, it feels like things are being introduced at random intervals. Like, the first trailer comes out on October. The second full-on trailer, releases in November. Like, I know that this movie got pushed back from its initial release date of Holiday 2022. And, I mean, like, the Sonic movie, it released, like, less than 5 months after its first trailer happened. Like, when the first trailer came out, it felt like an event. Like, this was the culmination, again, of like 5 years of waiting. And this was the first proper look we'd get at what the movie would be like. Like, the only other indicator we got was a teaser poster. And again, that teaser poster could easily be pretty misleading. So when the trailer came out, it felt a lot more exciting in general because would it look like it said in the poster? What would look different? How would the characters actually look compared to how they did in the games? Like, there was still some excitement to be had. Like, we only really got to see the Koopas, Bowser, Kamek, Toad, and Mario. And we got a brief glimpse at Luigi at the end. And so, then getting a proper glimpse at the other characters who were left out of the trailer, like Peach and Donkey Kong, again, that drummed up questions. And so you could have waited like 3 months after the first trailer released to release the second one. And then, you could have waited another 3 months to release the third trailer. just before the movie comes out. Like this way, you could have kept interest in the project and everything around it, without having to constantly throw content in the audience's face, reminding them that this thing releases in April. Like it's the Mario movie. People are going to remember that it exists. Overall, I've comprised my thoughts into one simple little sentence. I feel like Illumination is playing catch up with this movie. They felt pressured to start advertising when they did, and now they're trying to show us as much as they can before it's too late. It just goes to show that timing is everything. But with that said, you're probably wondering what I actually saw that led me to this opinion. Well, on the day of the trailer's release, we were given a slew of posters leading up to the actual presentation that showcased the designs for many of the characters, except Donkey Kong and Cranky Kong, who were shown briefly in the trailer. And as the months rolled on, we would get more posters like this, though they would be separate from releases of trailers or any other behind-the-scenes footage. And while that isn't a problem, one thing I mentioned is that these would be done in bursts, so it wouldn't just be one trailer or poster being revealed at a time. We would get a bunch of them all at once on the same day. And like, the posters aren't bad, but again, I think it would have been more fun if they like had us savor everything, so like every week or every 2 weeks, a new poster is shown. And like, the thing is, the movie is going to be relevant up until its release, but at the same time, if you release your posters more gradually, you could keep people talking about it. So that way, it wouldn't just have this big event to remind you the movie exists, and then you go radio silent till it's released. But I mean, the movie still garnered hype and people are still talking about it, so what do I know? So with that out of the way, let's hear my thoughts on this trailer as a whole. Again, I don't think this trailer was bad, but I feel like the hype that came with the first trailer is kinda missing here. But anyways, where the first trailer showed us actual scenes from the movie almost completely unedited, this trailer opts for more the traditional movie trailer approach, where they show us various clips from parts of the movie, with some lines either dubbed over or completely edited. Not only that, but the trailer puts a greater focus on characters who weren't really seen in the teaser. So we get looks at, say, Luigi, Peach, Donkey Kong, and a bit of Cranky Kong, but only a brief glimpse. And while the first trailer hinted at this idea, this trailer gives us confirmation that Mario and Luigi are going to start off in the human world and be sucked down into the Mushroom Kingdom. Something that has been referenced by fans before. Something that, unless you were on the internet actively searching details for this movie, you might not have known initially. Besides that, we get a few other hints of what might be in the movie in the future, including but not limited to power-ups, Yoshis, locations beyond the Mushroom and Koopa Kingdoms, and, most importantly, the Mario Karts. And we even get another moment of Chris Pratt flexing his voice acting skills, showing us once again that this role was not meant for him. Wahoo! I found that really neat, but if you listen carefully, you can actually hear a subtle message in the background. Let me play it again. You didn't hear it again? Well, let me play it back slower.
Fuck you!
Did you hear it now? I was just as annoyed when I heard that. I know I'm being a dead horse when I say it, but this is the main character, the one we're going to be hearing the most, so I have a right to be annoyed. And while these comments are not from my previous Mario movie video, or any video related to me, I would like to say that you're not simply a hater for disliking the choice of Chris Pratt as Mario. Rather, what would make you a hater was if you had a very petty or prejudiced reason for it. Whereas I have the problem that it feels like stunt casting without any proper back. We're two videos into this thing and I'm already relying on old material. And this won't be the first time either. Or the last. But anyways, aside from Mario and Luigi being sucked down into the Mushroom Kingdom, one thing that's also been confirmed is that the two are going to be split up somehow, with Luigi falling into Bowser's hands, and Mario landing in the Mushroom Kingdom, which we already knew. We also get brief clips of what is clearly a training montage, showing that Mario is actually training to become the Super Mario that we know from the games, which I think is a neat touch. I like that they're having Mario train for this rather than him being, you know, already good at running and jumping, and just so happens to be thrown into a world that caters to his abilities. It also explains why Mario would be so good at fighting these enemies in the first place. They train specifically for them. Also, I like that it's Luigi who gets kidnapped in this case. Like, one thing that could easily have been done is that they could have easily explained, like, this is Peach's first kidnapping or whatever. But no, I like that they went a more creative direction. Like, the Sonic movie was how Sonic met Eggman and everything and how that happened, but they still did interesting things around it. Now, I don't have as much to say about Luigi since he isn't as present in this trailer as Peach is, or Mario, or Bowser, so I'm just gonna get my thoughts out now. Luigi is an addition to the already massive line of good redesigns this movie has. Like, one thing I noticed with him and Mario upon closer inspection is that you can even see a bit of wear and tear on the areas of Luigi's outfits that cover his joints. The same goes with Mario, specifically for like the overalls, you can see there's a bit more wrinkles everywhere. And Charlie Day actually doesn't sound too bad as him either. Like, I was initially on the fence since Charlie Day's voice is pretty high, but upon hearing it, it actually doesn't sound too bad. Like, compared to Chris Pratt as Mario, Charlie actually seems to be trying, even though the voice doesn't sound that much like Luigi. Here's a little comparison between their voices.
An identical outfit with a hat with the letter of his first name on it! Because I don't!
Ah! Fine, I'll do the dishes! You're just gonna make me do them anyway!
Thank you for calling Super Mario Brothers Plumbing. It's a me, Luigi. And you need service.
Okay, well, Charlie work is like, you know, like basement stuff, cleaning urinals, blood stuff, your basic slimes, your sludge.
So with that finished, let's move on to Princess Peach. As I said earlier, where the first trailer opted to focus on Mario and Bowser, this trailer focuses on Charlie Day's Luigi and Anya Taylor-Joy's Peach. What was I saying? Oh yeah, let's hear how she sounds.
Bowser is coming. Together, we are going to stop that monster.
You remember what I said a little while back about the horse? We're two videos into this thing and I'm already relying on old material. And this won't be the first time either, or the last. Well, I hope you're ready for that mess. I am conflicted with my opinions on Peach. On one hand, I'm glad that they didn't just have Anya Taylor-Joy sound like herself. Like, I know I praise Charlie Day's Luigi, but I'd say that's probably my only big gripe with him. He just sounds like Charlie. But at the same time, they like picked the most generic voice for Peach. Like, this isn't like Keegan-Michael Key as Toad, where they had a voice that was different, but still sounded in line with the character. No, instead they just picked the most generic Disney princess sounding voice that they could find. And what annoys me about this is that Anya Taylor-Joy is British. She has a British accent. And granted, that doesn't immediately mean like, oh, her voice won't sound generic. But like, you could do something with that. Again, this is a different take on the characters. Something we haven't had in a long time. And I know I talked about that and Mario not necessarily having that luxury, but this could have been a way that they differentiated from the games. And again, this isn't me just saying that, oh, the video game voice is better. Because no, like Toad, Peach would have needed a change of voice. It would have gotten a bit irritating to hear, but also, again, you can still do something unique. Yet another recycled point from my older video is that Sonic, in the Sonic movie, not only is he voiced by Ben Schwartz, who is known as a voice actor, but Sonic has a unique sounding voice. Well, yeah, it's kind of the voice Ben Schwartz uses for a lot of his characters. Again, it's different. It doesn't sound like Sonic, but it doesn't sound like Ben either. And that's what I'm trying to say. That's what they could have done here. That's my biggest problem with Peach's voice, is that they had the chance to do something different or something interesting, but instead went with what was, in my opinion, the safest option. Now, for those who need a better idea of what I'm trying to get across here, here are some examples of celebrities voicing characters in animated shows or movies. Let's take a look at Eddie Redmayne. This is his normal voice.
Actually, no. I'm a proud Hufflepuff.
This is his voice in the Fantastic Beasts movies.
Unity in America?
I do know a few things, actually. I know that you have rather backwards laws about relations with non-magic people. That you're not meant to befriend them, that you can't marry them, which seems mildly absurd. Because I like you. Because you're my friend.
And this is his voice in Thomas and Friends.
Branch line? I think that's where I'm meant to be working. My name is Ryan. And I'll be your engine today. Ready?
Now let's take a look at Jamie Campbell-Bauer. This is his normal voice.
I mean, absolutely not. I mean, I never even imagined I'd be on a show like this, let alone playing this thing. It's amazing. It was just such a blessing. The whole thing feels like such a whirlwind since I got it. It's bizarre.
This is his voice in Stranger Things.
I'm sorry about this, everyone.
I'm just a girl standing in front of a boy, asking him to love her.
And this is his voice in Thomas and Friends.
It is time, Meg. Time for you to join me.
Just messing with you. That's also from the Jimmy Fallon interview.
Okay. We've been sailing up and down this coast for years. We're searching for the secret cove where Captain Callus kept his ship. But it sounds like you fell right into it.
You see what I'm saying here? I'm not saying that they should never have hired celebrities in the first place, but that those celebrities could give better performances. Now, enough with the negativity. Time to be a broken record about something good. Like Luigi, Peach has received an amazing redesign. It reminds me a bit of her design in the Super Smash Bros. Games, how those went and added a lot more details to her dress, as well as her crown. On top of that, her biker suit looks quite accurate to how it was in every game after Mario Kart Wii. And it wasn't just me. The whole internet collectively had the reaction of someone who's never seen a female character in any sort of animated media before. On top of that, I really like Peach's character in this movie. Like, Peach wasn't given much of a personality in the games, but here she clearly seems to be like a sort of diplomat type leader. She seems to be someone who, like, is aware of the threat and is trying to rally everyone together. Also, a really fun thing that I noticed is that Peach is the one who's going to help Mario be training for this whole fight with Bowser, so this is something I find neat. Like, again, Mario's learning how to fight all these enemies, and who better to do it than the one who knows them best? Other than Bowser, of course. It reminds me of this thing I saw on Pinterest where a person was listing off some of the stuff they would like to see in more, like, media in general. One of them being a woman teaching a man how to fight. And so, armed with that information, this also shows us that Peach is definitely going to be a more proactive character, and is actually going to be able to defend herself against Bowser. Like, again, instead of it just being that Luigi is kidnapped and Mario goes to save him, Luigi is kidnapped by Bowser, who is planning an attack on the Mushroom Kingdom, which we can infer from what Peach says. Bowser is coming, which means that a lot of the actions she takes in this movie are in response to the impending threat, which I think was an interesting decision. Not only because it shows us that Peach has ears everywhere, but lets us know that Peach is a bit more of a strategist. Overall, I'm really happy with this interpretation of Peach, or what we've seen so far. I really like the ideas that the Mario movie is posing with, like, their takes on the characters, and so I really hope that the movie is able to do them all justice. And with that, we've finished part 2 of this Mario movie analysis. Unfortunately though, we're not done yet, as we still have December and early 2023 to discuss.
Now you die.
Please!
Oh boy, I just got the notification. Let's see what Al Limonaire is uploading today. Yeah, we're doing this again. Hey everybody, this is the Al Limonaire once again coming to talk to you about the Super Mario Bros. Movie.
Stop!
Yeah, I know. How many more times can this guy milk a single topic for views? But in my defense, this hurts me more than it hurts you. And plus, I've never been one to throw away an opportunity. Now, since this and my last Mario movie video came out pretty close together, I'm not really going to do much of a recap. Just to say that I talked mostly about the second trailer, and I spent most of my time complaining about like the release of the posters, as well as Princess Peach's voice. So with that settled, let's pick up where we left off. So you remember how in the previous video, I talked about how the second trailer came out less than 2 months after the first? Well, Illumination continued that pattern, as when the Game Awards came around, they revealed an entire scene from the Mario movie. Don't even think a Nintendo game was nominated. The scene in question is one we haven't been shown before in any capacity, that being a scene of Mario and Toad going through the Mushroom Kingdom trying to get to Peach's castle. Now, while this wasn't the first look that we got at the Mario movie, I feel like this scene really kind of cemented the kind of movie that this was going to be in a lot of fans' eyes. To put this into perspective, this scene was full of references to the games galore. You had Toads hitting item boxes in order to get coins. You had, like, the pipes being used to traverse through different parts of the kingdom. Like, the way the references are implemented feels very organic, like, oh, Mario gets coins out of, like, an item box? That's how Toads get, like, money to pay for everything. Or, like, some of the floating bricks or platforms that, like, move around are used as, like, elevators or such to move people around the place. I can't speak for everyone when I say this, but while like the first and second trailer were good, this reveal feels like what really got people on the movie's side. You had so many pieces of music from the Mario series being adapted, and they were like all done in orchestral form, and each one led into the next. Like, to top it all off, you had Mario stumbling through all of this, which will, you know, compared to how he gets better later, it's just such a nice touch. Like, this feels like the references in both Sonic movies, but it's basically cranked up to 11. Like, you remember the poster and what it showed? This scene is basically the entire teaser poster in like one whole like motion. And again, this is why I feel like the early marketing for the movie should have been more spread out. Like, imagine if you had gone from like hearing about the voice cast and mid to late 2021 to then like seeing the first teaser in October of 2022, and like rather than getting the second trailer a month later, like less than 2 months later, you just got this full scene from the movie. Like, imagine how exciting that would have been, because all we'd have had to go off was the first trailer and what was a slightly edited version of one of the movie's scenes. Like the first teaser, you would only get to see like Mario and the Toads. You wouldn't know like what any of the other characters aside from like Bowser, Kamek, and the Koopas looked like, and a brief glimpse of Luigi. Peach and Donkey Kong would still be up in the air. And like, I feel Peach especially would have drummed up more excitement given that the scene ends with Mario and Toad arriving at the doors to her castle. But like I said in the last video, what do I really know? The sneak peek still got a lot of praise from fans. But then again, positive reception does not mean that something is immediately flawless. Look at the Sonic movies. Despite being the highest grossing video game movie as of its release, those movies were still met with a lot of criticism, even from their biggest supporters. And that's what has me worried about the Mario movie. Like, Sonic was on shaky ground, and that's why it got so much criticism. On top of that, like, the films did do a bit to appeal to kids a bit too much, but with the Mario movie, I feel like people are kind of being won over a bit too quickly, and so it's going to make it a lot harder to criticize the film without being met with certain bits of criticism. Like, I can't even have a conversation about a movie I dislike or have less interest in without my siblings kind of ganging up on me. But anyways, before I get off topic, I'd like to talk about what came after. What came after was a few like short bursts of smaller ads for the movie that you'd see on like YouTube or TV. These ads didn't have too much substantial content. They mostly just showed expanded versions of the scenes that were heavily edited in like the second trailer. Scenes such as Bowser's oncoming invasion, Mario's training montage, and Luigi being kidnapped. And they gave us a better look at Seth Rogen's Donkey Kong. Much like the second trailer, we got a lot of new posters for the movie to advertise it. And while they're not completely accurate to scenes from the movie, a lot more of them were based on things that actually happened. Whereas the previous posters were kind of just things to show off the characters. Though unlike the last set of posters, these ones weren't released to coincide with any kind of trailer, and kind of just came out on their own. Though, like I said before, I kind of wish that they had gone for a more spread out release strategy, instead of just showing off a bunch of posters at once. I mean, besides that, we got the Super Mario Bros. Plumbing commercial, which was fun. I like that they used the original Super Show theme song, though I'm not too well versed in that stuff. But anyways, with that out of the way, it's time to get to what you probably clicked on the video for, the third trailer. Now, personal opinion here, but I haven't felt hyped for this movie since the second trailer.
Fool this man!
Now, don't get me wrong, I've been like waiting for the movie, I've been wanting to see its release, but it just feels like, again, Illumination has just been playing catch up with this movie. Like, after the first trailer, we didn't get too much in the way of like more exposure for the movie until like the second trailer came around in late November. But then after that, it seems like every other week we're getting like an ad for this movie. Like, I can't turn on YouTube or TV or anything really without getting a commercial for the Super Mario Bros. Movie. And the thing is, like, sometimes it's just the same stuff that you see in like the trailers and whatnot, and other times they're just showing us a bunch of other spoilers and other scenes from the film, and so it feels like we're just getting the movie before it's even come out. Like, it's harder to feel hyped for it and wonder, oh hey, what's gonna happen? When, you know, you're basically being shown everything. And this isn't just the Mario movie's problem, by the way. This is a problem with, like, the movie industry at large, where they will reveal huge chunks of the movie, including things that are meant to be, like, a surprise, in, like, the first trailer, like, the first look we ever get at it. But anyways, that's enough complaining. So, what was in the trailer itself? Again, like most of the ads leading up to the third trailer, it didn't show us much in the way of new content, but it did show us like a few little things, like say we see Donkey Kong being able to use power-ups, we see Mario use like the Super Mushroom and fight a few enemies, Bowser addresses some of his other minions. But I think the most noteworthy thing about this trailer was at the beginning. Now, for reference, at the start of the third trailer, we're given a shot of Bowser's lair, and we see Luigi being dropped down in a cage, not too different from the ones that Bowser normally uses to hold Peach. This cage is dropped down to Bowser's dungeon, where we see a whole variety of other characters, mostly Bowser's other minions like Drybones and Goombas. However, among them are the penguins that we saw in the first trailer, and a Luma. Now, for anyone who doesn't know what Lumas are, Lumas first appeared in 2007 in the game Super Mario Galaxy. They're these little star-shaped creatures who are, like, cared for by this one other princess-type character known as Rosalina. Now, with the presence of a Luma being here in this trailer, we can infer that Rosalina is going to make some kind of cameo or is going to appear potentially in the next movie. And now, one of the reasons I'm treating such a minor detail as such a big thing with regards to the movie is that it shows that Nintendo isn't just reaching for the very distant past. Like, in a lot of shows or movies use nostalgia, they always try to bring back, like, the first iteration of a series. Like, the first Power Rangers series, the first Ghostbusters movie, and whatnot. We don't really see them pull from all reaches of a movie or show's history. And so, to have Lumas, which are, 2007 wasn't a recent time, but to have them be pulling from like less than 20 years ago and such with this, it shows that they really are trying to pay tribute to Mario's history, and not just the smaller things that like paved the way, or not just Mario's first steps. Now, having seen a lot more of the movie, and I do mean a lot more, I feel now I'm ready to share more of my preconceived notions with you guys, or at the very least, the reservations I have about this movie. While I know that this is an Illumination movie, and Illumination movies are usually PG and meant for younger audiences, I hope that that's not the only demographic they have in mind. Like, we saw the Sonic movie, and one complaint that many people had with that was that it tried a bit too hard to appeal to kids. But at the same time though, I'm hoping that they don't try to go too far in the other direction, and basically try to appeal to everyone, thus appealing to no one. What they should do is have a specific demographic in mind, but then make sure that everyone else can enjoy it. What I mean by this is that, for example, you can have a show that is made to appeal to children. Like, there are a lot of shows recently that are like, you know, animated cartoons meant for younger audiences, but there are grown-ups and like teenagers and such who are able to enjoy it as well for other aspects. Or for another example, there are shows like Voltron or She-Ra that are reboots of an existing property from like the 80s, and while they have like their newer fans and such, or the younger generations get into them, there are fans of the older shows and the earlier versions of these characters who are also able to respect or find enjoyment from what they are watching. So making a movie that's able to reference things that the fans enjoy, as well as the general public knows about Mario, is going to be a tricky balancing act. Speaking of which, I'm worried the movie might be relying too much on references to the games. For reference, of the things and characters we know are going to be in this movie, we know that they're going to have Mario characters, Yoshis, Donkey Kong characters, they're going to introduce the Power Stars, the Mario Karts. Like, it feels like a bit too much for one movie, especially since the runtime has now been confirmed to be 90 minutes. And that's not even taking into account all of the smaller references and things that you'd really have to pay attention to if you were a Mario fan or just someone who was getting into Mario. Like, I can already see the Screen Crush or whatever channel's videos talking about like everything you missed in the Mario movie, and it's just them live streaming the movie and pausing it whenever they see something they recognize. And even then, that might not be enough, because like, who knows, that pebble over there, that could be a character, that could be a reference to like Womp or something. Or like, there could be one red hair on Peach's head that we missed, because Peach was originally a redhead in the first Super Mario Bros. Like, you see the problem I have here? I feel like if the movie keeps putting in references, or if there are more references than the ones we've seen, then the movie won't have room for any original ideas of its own. But like, one thing you'll notice is that, again, when you're watching like both Sonic movies, you'll notice that they kind of pick and choose what they want to have in the movies, and what they want to be their own ideas, like say, Sonic's origin, or the use of the Master Emerald, or things like that. Not everything is a reference, and the things that are actually play a meaningful part. And again, this brings me back to the point of the Mario movie needing to have like a set demographic. Because like, you can't rely exclusively on the fans of a series to drive your ticket sales. No matter what you see on like the internet of people complaining about changes or movies that are like reboots or such failing financially. That isn't just the fans, that's general audiences showing that they weren't too pleased with this. Like, every demographic knows about Mario in some capacity, but each one has different kinds of knowledge about him. So knowing that, of course there are going to be people who will feel a bit alienated by some of the references, but some people won't feel like that. In fact, sometimes, seeing these other references to things they weren't aware of might encourage them to go check those things out. So overall, those are my reservations with regards to what the Mario movie is doing, now that I have knowledge of everything that's going to be in it. I want you guys to know that I don't hate the Mario movie. Whenever I become critical like this, it's because I like the thing I'm seeing. Sometimes I wonder about how I could improve it, or at least what you could do better. Granted, people only really say these kinds of things after they've seen everything that they're being shown. So, who knows, maybe there's something I missed that I'll do when I actually review the movie. And plus, for as much flack as I gave this movie, I still have more faith in it than Eternals.
I finally found it! Now who's gonna stop me?!
Overall, I am hesitantly optimistic for the Mario movie. I really like the ideas that the Mario movie is posing with, like, their takes on the characters. And so I really hope that the movie is able to do them all justice. I want you guys to know that I don't hate the Mario movie. Whenever I become critical like this, it's because I like the thing I'm seeing. Sometimes I wonder about how I could improve it, or at least what you could do better. And plus, for as much flack as I gave this movie, I still have more faith in it than Eternals. Okay, I got my heart attack medicine in my pocket. I've got 911 on the line with defibrillators ready in case of anything. And I got a nightstick. Can't have spoilers getting out.
One movie later.
Well, that was a waste of overcompensation. Prepare for a weird video. Hello everyone, this is the Eliminator again. And that's right, I saw the Super Mario Bros. Movie.
Finally!
And today, I am going to express my opinions on the movie itself this time, rather than all the events surrounding it. This is actually the format that I plan to do for a lot of my later videos now. The reason I did my specific format for the Mario movie is because the movie wasn't out yet, so all I could really do was speculate on it. But now that that's done, we can finally get into what this series is really about, the review. So, to make things easier for everyone, I'm just gonna go over everything I've already mentioned in every video prior to this one, so that we can focus more on the new stuff. Now, enough stalling. With formalities out of the way,
here we go!
So, starting things off, we have the voice actor. Of course, there's Chris Pratt and Anya Taylor-Joy, who don't sound terrible, but not great. Whereas, like, Jack Black and Charlie Day kinda sweep the floor. Even Seth Rogen did an alright job. So overall, the voice acting was a mixed bag. Not too good, not too bad, with one notable exception. And then you had the redesigns, which were probably my favorite part of the movie. Especially since nothing could compare to the blonde-haired, blue-eyed, royally dressed...
No!
Excuse me? You already used that joke before. Try something original. Hey, whose video is this?
Oh yeah?
Who has the power to unsubscribe? Fine. It'll be the last thing you see anyways. That's good. Wait, what? How's that for an original joke? Anyone else have any complaints? Sorry about that. I got a bit carried away. Now, as I was saying, you can really feel Nintendo's involvement with this movie with how the characters were designed, where they retain the same shape, but again have slight alterations to their appearance, either to make them more expressive or to add more detail for, you know, the cinematic quality that they're going for with the design. As I mentioned in part 1, it's really just little details like the green scales on Bowser's face creeping down to his shoulders, Kamek having wrinkles and being more hunched over because he's older, and Mario and Luigi having more wear and tear on the knee areas of their overalls because that's where they'd get the most use. I also like the detail of Toad having actual pants this time, whereas before his legs just looked kinda like the base of a deviled egg. Peach's dress and crown are also a lot more detailed. Like, Peach's crown looks like the kind of thing that I would see someone like posting on Pinterest as part of their cosplay. And while the dress isn't as detailed as, say, Super Smash Bros., I like the details that you can like see the seam lines on the sleeves, the torso area and such, showing where it was like put together. Now that I've gotten the old news out of the way,
it's time for the moment you've been waiting for.
What did I think of the Mario movie? Now, as I have said in my previous videos, given that the Mario movie hadn't released yet, I've been trying to temper my expectations, you know, make sure that I don't go in with any preconceived notions or come out too disappointed. So that way, when I talk about the movie, my criticism feels a lot more fair. Now let's get started for real this time. So, right off the bat, I'd like to say that this movie has an amazing soundtrack. Like, as we expected, it's filled with renditions of different Mario themes throughout the years, and unfortunately I can't really play any of them for you right now, but surprisingly, the Mario theme is not played that often throughout the movie. Like, it's played when Mario discovers the Mushroom Kingdom, and if you count the Super Mario Bros. Rap, I mean, that's basically twice. Other than that, I don't really think I heard it anywhere else. But in regards to, like, other themes, like, you have the Superstar theme playing during the final fight. You have, like, the underground theme as Mario and Luigi look through the city's sewer system. And there's even an instance where Peach's Castle's theme is used. It's like this movie took one of the main complaints about the Sonic movie, that being its underutilization of the game's soundtrack, and basically went the opposite direction. Speaking of which, another difference between Mario and Sonic is how the Mario cast is characterized in this movie. Now, while the Sonic movie opted to go for new interpretations of its characters, while still borrowing and recontextualizing elements from the games, the Mario movie opts instead to take aspects of the games and then expand upon them. For example, in the games, Mario goes on all these unique adventures to different lands and goes racing and playing sports, but it just so happens that he is a plumber. Whereas in the movie, Mario and Luigi are plumbers first and foremost, and then acquire all the other skills later on. Now, one thing I like about this approach is that it gives us a better explanation as to why these characters are the way they are. Even if the movie isn't canon, it's nice to have a more fleshed out version of Mario or Bowser or Peach. Admittedly though, my only problem with these motivations is that they are either something we've seen before or has been done better in, like, Mario's spin-off material or such, or is a fairly basic motivation. Like, Peach is characterized as being a very capable, strong, independent leader, but we don't really get to know much beyond that. We don't get to know what makes her tick. Or, like, Bowser is shown to be in love with Peach, maybe to the point of obsession. But, unlike in the games and such, it's kind of just his only other trait, aside from being, like, King of the Koopas. There isn't the stuff that the RPGs did, or any of the three-dimensionality that Bowser is given, that really made him such a fun character in those games. And then I'd say that Mario kind of has it the worst, because, like, Mario is given, like, the storyline that, oh, he wants to become a plumber and such, but nobody believes in him. No one wants him to follow his dreams or such. And the thing is, like, this doesn't exactly feel like a Mario storyline. And what I mean by that is that, like, it feels less like it's a character thing for Mario, and more like something a character like Luigi would have to deal with. But since Luigi's been taken out of the movie for more than half the story, I guess they just had to shuffle that onto Mario. And, like, there are plenty more examples I could give here, but for the sake of time, and for the sake of making the same argument over and over again, or, well, not trying to do that, let's continue. Now, unfortunately, in terms of utilization, the story isn't that much better. This section will contain spoilers, so if you guys don't want to see that, skip to this time card. But for those of you who've already seen the movie, or don't really care, here we go! So, the story of this movie is that Bowser has gone and ravaged the Snow Kingdom, which was home to the penguins we saw in the first trailer. After doing this, he collects the Superstar, which the penguins were guarding, and plans to destroy the Mushroom Kingdom, using it and his army. Meanwhile, Mario and Luigi want to establish a pummeling business, but they can't really seem to do any jobs well. So, after trying to fix the city's sewer system, Mario and Luigi get sucked down a pipe, leading to the Mushroom Kingdom. The Luigi gets sucked down a separate entrance to the Darklands, controlled by Bowser. As you'd expect, Luigi is kidnapped, and because of this, Mario goes to save him, joining up with Princess Peach, Donkey Kong, Toad, and some of the others. So, as you can see, this is a fairly basic story for a Mario movie. And that's not my personal problem here. My problem is not that the story itself is basic. You can tell a basic story, but still do a remarkable job with it. The problem here is that the movie doesn't do anything to subvert my expectations. Everything you see is everything you get. And the reason I find this annoying is also because the movie itself has some interesting ideas that it can do with its characters. But the movie just moves too fast, and it makes it hard for you to really feel for anything on screen. Like, you know the song that Bowser sings, you know, the one about his love for Princess Peach? That song is only 90 minutes long. Not only that, but in the movie, Bowser's song gets cut off by another character. Or when Mario, Peach, and Toad are traveling over to, like, the Jungle Kingdom, It's mostly just a montage of them going from different places. And like, it's cool and all, I can see all the references there. But at the same time, think, you could have had like the characters talking as they're traveling and sharing exposition about each other. Like maybe we learn about Peach's backstory while they're traveling to the Fireflower Field. Or we learn about Toad's background. Or we learn more about why Mario wanted to start a plumbing business in the first place. And then there are scenes where like Bowser is getting word from his informants that Mario and whoever are going wherever or doing whatever. Like, Kamek somehow knows that Peach has been training Mario to like run and jump, which happened over like the course of a single night. How did he know that? There was never any indication that Kamek was hiding among the Toads or anything. Or when Mario and them make their way to the Jungle Kingdom, we're never given any indication that any of the Koopas were following them or spying on them along the way. When Mario, Peach, and Toad are traveling over to like the Jungle Kingdom, it's mostly just a montage of them going from Another example of this would be Luigi getting kidnapped. Like, throughout the story, we're given hints of Luigi being a bit more scared than Mario, and they bring it up a few times, but then by the movie, he's suddenly just braver, with no prior experience. Unlike Mario, who has gone through an obstacle course, fought an ape, survived a road rage on a flying space road, and then broke up a wedding. Mario went to hell and back, but Luigi was in hell. More importantly, Luigi was in hell but never showed any signs of growth or change. He doesn't seem to really be affected by any of the experiences he's been in, which leads me to the point that they should not have split Mario and Luigi up. Obviously, it's the Super Mario Bros. Movie, but for the other reason being that one character actually has a lot more of a personality to them, that being Luigi, and he's the one that gets taken out. Like, Mario doesn't have much of a personality, and he doesn't even have much of an arc in this movie. Like, honestly, I think Mario would have been better if he was a character with a flat arc. That being that, rather than Mario growing and changing throughout the movie, Mario already knows what the moral of the story is, and rather, he teaches it to the other characters. Now, the reason this doesn't make Mario a boring character is because Mario can still be a flawed character. He just so happens to know what the moral of this specific scenario is. So, for example, you could still have Mario be very overly optimistic. You could have him not always see the negatives or the drawbacks to a certain decision. So that way, you can still keep it flawed. You can still have Mario maybe cause a piece of the conflict, but rather than it being out of Mario's ignorance for the main message of the story, it's more just a bit of character building, or more just something that happens because of his character. So that way, your character still has a personality and a presence, but is still active in the story. A good example of this would be the first Back to the Future movie, wherein the main character, Marty, is a very confident person who asserts himself and stands up to bullies. And while he does cause some conflicts, like he nearly damages the space-time continuum, that isn't the main conflict. That isn't the main problem that his character is facing. Instead, Marty is teaching others to stand up for themselves, namely his father in the past. And that's only one of the ways I can think of when it comes to altering some of the Mario movies' content. Now that we've got an idea of what's wrong with the Mario movie's story, let's see some ways that it could be improved. So, let's move on to the next section. Note that this won't be a complete and utter rewrite like some channels, but rather, this is simply me making alterations to existing scenes in the movies to see how they can better convey the message that they are trying to get across. And while I will try to add my own scenes or alter some scenes a bit more heavily than others, I will still make the existing content or purpose of the scene relevant. Now let's do this one last time. Okay, so I'd keep the opening exactly the same, as well as the whole like Super Mario Bros. Plumbing commercial scene, because those are genuinely solid scenes and do a good job of establishing the characters and where they are. But it's everything afterwards that I'd probably alter. Like, for example, rather than it just being Mario and Luigi's plumbing business is being, you know, dragged on by everyone, maybe Luigi could be the specific aspect of it that they're dragging on, because Luigi is often seen as inferior to Mario. Maybe during the argument with Mario and his parents, maybe it's Luigi that they're complaining about. Like, oh, Luigi left a stable job and now he's gonna hold Mario back from his career. Another way you could do this is earlier in the story, when Mario and Luigi are in the pizzeria marveling at their commercial. Instead of Spike just making fun of both of the Mario brothers, maybe he's specifically taking pot shots at Luigi, mentioning like, I can understand Mario leaving to start his own business, but you just made a big mistake. To which Mario stands up for Luigi like he did before. Maybe when Mario sees on the news that the city's water main is malfunctioning, he doesn't just think that this is the chance to become heroes, but specifically a chance for Luigi to prove himself. This way, you could do a slightly better job establishing the brotherly bond between Mario and Luigi, that, despite everything everyone says about Luigi, Mario still cares about him enough to want to do this with him. Now, having heard everything that I've mentioned previously, you can probably guess what I'm about to say next. Mario and Luigi do not get split up. However, I would have the situation play out differently, as Mario and Luigi both land in the Darklands this time, and both of them encounter the Shy Guys and the Drybones. That's right, both of them get captured and taken to Bowser, and then they learn of Bowser's plot to destroy the Mushroom Kingdom, prompting them to escape and find Princess Peach. From there, things continue the same with the training montage. However, instead of it being Mario and Peach having a heart-to-heart, it's Peach and Luigi talking about how Luigi has always felt like he's been in Mario's shadow, due to Mario always having to stand up for him. How this would be shown is that when training on the obstacle course, Mario seems to be getting a handle on everything, whereas Luigi just keeps struggling and failing again and again. This way, it would make it so that Luigi's insecurities aren't unfounded, as well as everyone's perception of him as a bit of a failure. After that, I would keep most of the stuff the same, like with the travel montage, though I would actually show evidence of Bowser like having informants and eyes all around the place, letting him know about Mario and Peach's situation. On top of that, I'd have the Mario and Donkey Kong fight be more evenly matched to show again just how capable Mario is, reaffirming Luigi's insecurities. Another example of this that I have in mind would be the Rainbow Road sequence, where Mario and Donkey Kong get separated from everyone else. Instead of just having it be that a random spiky Koopa attacks them, I'd have it be that Luigi is put into a vulnerable position that forces Mario and Donkey Kong to risk themselves to save him, resulting in the two of them getting thrown off and everyone else being left to the wolves. This way, you could really play into Luigi's insecurities by having him cause such a major problem and creating the all is lost moment, rather than it just coming out of nowhere. So then, afterwards, when they're, say, breaking up the wedding and then saving Brooklyn from Bowser, it really feels impactful because we just saw Luigi have such a major slip-up. Not only that, but it would then make Mario showing support for him in all those other scenes a lot more impactful, because we now see what Luigi can do when others believe in him. Now, having gone through all of that, I think it's time we wrap things up. Thank you guys for watching. Be sure to like, share, subscribe, and tell me down in the comments section. Have your thoughts on the Mario movie changed at all since last year? If so, how have they? If not, why? Personally, my thoughts haven't changed at all since then, but that's just me. Let me know what you think. Subscribe today to join the A-list, and have a good day. Bye!